that sealed the promise. Your very body began to.
That's exciting, church!
Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared the grave has no claim on me. Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your very body began to breathe.
Yours is the victory.
is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder. Show me who you are and fill me with your light and lead me in your love to those around me. I will build my life upon your love. It is a firm foundation. I will put my trust in you alone, and I will not be shaken.
Let's pray. Well, Father, we just thank you once again, and we just praise you and praise your name, Lord, as you are worthy of all praise, Father. Father, I pray as we take up this offering, Lord, that you would just bless our church with it, Lord, and bless those who give it, Lord, and just give us the wisdom just how to use it, Lord. Father, we thank you again. It's in your Son, Jesus' name. Amen.
Oh, Lord, my sings my soul, my Savior God to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art, how great thou art.
Bye, sweet girl. Everybody say bye, kids. Everybody say good. No, that's not true. My goodness, it's a good day to be in the house of the Lord. Hey, if I don't preach one Sunday, can I preach twice as long the next? I got one amen and 300 oh my's. Oh, it's good to be here. Sorry we didn't get to come last week, and you know, in Northwest Arkansas, a lot of times it's kind of hit or miss, and we always fall on the side of safety for folks. And so I hope that you had an opportunity to either watch the service on TV, go back into lakeviewnwa.com and play a rerun, or something else. But anyway, thank you for being here this morning. You know, we're in this God question series, and we probably have a couple of weeks left in it, but we could probably go all year on something like this. But the God question I want us to look at this morning is, does faith really matter? Does faith really matter? I mean, so many people struggle with this question. A lot of Christians don't even really understand what faith means, or certainly don't live in faith, because you can see in their life, and I'm not being judgmental, just when we go into problematic times in our lives, you know, when faith ought to be at the strongest, it seems like we're the weakest, and I'm pointing four fingers at myself. I mean, sometimes the message of the gospel's being drowned out, and not just by unbelievers, even within our churches, people get shackled to the idea that the only way to God is through us living a godly life and doing all these things to get to God. It's as if grace don't really matter, and all that matters is my works, and that is so problematic, so anti-Bible, that it's not even real. So let's dive into that a little bit this morning. Man, don't get me wrong. When you start living for Christ, you start living in the love of Christ, good works should flow out of you, because you were changed. You're a different person. You're different from the inside out. And so we should have more good works. We should be more empathetic. We should be more in love with other people. All these things. But it's the cart before the horse when you say, that's who I've got to be before God will love me. Are you with me? Amen. Because God takes us where we are and makes us into who he wants us to be, not the opposite. So, you know, the more Christ that flows in you, the more of Christ will flow out. But it starts with being completely sold out to the idea that it's all God and really none of us other than our willingness to follow God. Amen? And so we want to look at that this morning in some depth. So if you'll turn with me to Galatians chapter 5, we're going to read verses 1 through 6 as we go along here. I'll read it in its entirety, and then we'll go back and we'll unpack that as we go along. I love this passage out of Galatians. Paul is writing this letter to a group of people that really doesn't know a lot about God, doesn't know a lot about Judaism and all those things that go along with it. And so he's really explaining what the Christian faith looks like in terms that is very much in line with that day and time. So let's read it. Galatians chapter 5, starting with verse 1. It is for freedom that Christ has set us free. Stand firm then, and do not let yourselves be burdened again by a yoke of slavery. Okay, so far so good. But in verse 2 and following, it gets a little bit strange for us. But as we read through this, don't lose me, because we're going to come back and we're going to explain verses 2 through 4 in some detail. But here it is. Mark my words, Paul said, I, Paul, tell you that if you let yourselves be circumcised, Christ will be of no value to you at all. Again, I declare to every man who lets himself be circumcised that he is obligated to obey the whole law. You who are trying to be justified or made right by law have been alienated or separated from Christ. You have fallen away from grace. Okay, that was a mouthful in verses 2 through 4. But I think you'll really like it when you see it in the context of what Paul's writing to this Galatian people. So give me a minute and we'll catch up with that. Verse 5. But by faith, we eagerly await through the Spirit the righteousness for which we hope. For in Christ Jesus, neither circumcision nor uncircumcision has any value. The only thing that counts is faith expressing itself through love. Paul goes on in verse 13. It says, you, my brothers, were called to be free. Let's pray. Father, I just praise you. I give you praise, Lord, for what we've already experienced here. Thank you, Lord, for this opportunity to be in your house. Lord, I pray that you would open up this word for us this morning and show us what it means to truly live in the grace that you've given us and the faith that's ours to be had through Christ Jesus. In his precious name we pray. Amen. Okay, so lest you don't know, being circumcised is the trimming of the foreskin of the, you know what? So with that thought in mind, girls cannot be circumcised. So you girls, that there's still something to be learned from this today. So you stick with me here, okay? In the Old Testament days, being circumcised meant that you identified with the old covenant and the laws that went along with it. But at its best, it was still a works-based relationship. It was doing all these things so that we could be good enough for God to have us. That's not the way the New Testament works. But the best thing about the Old Testament, that it was put there to point people to the Messiah, the one that would be our Redeemer, or the one that would pay for our sins. But listen, Jesus did not come to do away with the Old Testament. He came to fulfill it, and that's what he does. And in doing that, it gives us freedom from the do's and the these and the thous and all of that. But Jesus came to buy us back from that. But that freedom requires faith. So does faith matter? Does faith matter? Let's look at it. Three things. Does faith matter? Faith matters. If you're taking notes, faith matters, but only when you believe it. Faith matters, but only when you believe it. Verse 1, Galatians chapter 5, verse 1. What does he say? He says, it is for freedom that Christ set us free. So we know all the things that goes along with Christ setting us free. He came, lived a sinless life, died on the cross, rose from the dead, goes back to the right hand of the Father to make intercession for us. That's the freedom that Jesus gave us. And so it says in continuing verse 1, stand firm then, because you can stand firm then, and do not let yourselves be burdened again by a yoke of slavery. Can I say one thing on a little side road here for a second? When God gives you freedom, the only way you'll lose that freedom is to choose to lose it. Because God's freedom is so overwhelming, so all-encompassing, and it is all so there for you that if you don't use it, it is not God's fault, it is your fault. Everybody say amen? Anybody agree with that? Y'all just think pastor's being judgmental this morning, don't you? I hadn't preached in 2 weeks, so I have a little thing that I, anyway. Paul tells us in verse 1, it's for freedom that Christ set us free. He's telling us that Jesus came to earth, lived a perfect life, died on the cross, shed his blood for us, rose from the dead to set us free from the grip of Satan. And he didn't give us that freedom to have us put ourselves into another type of bondage. Jesus already knew that you were not good enough and I am not good enough to have salvation on our own, nor are we good enough to keep it afterwards. It is about God, it is all about God, and it will always be about God. Then why do we have that freedom? Because God provided it for us. Why did he do that? Because God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. Listen to this. Whatever you place your trust in, whatever you place your trust in, that's where you'll put your faith in. I found this translation that I really liked out of the New Century Version translation of the Bible. It's in Hebrews chapter 11, verse 1. Most of you know that, but I like this translation. Faith means being sure of the things we hope for. Okay, I'll get to the rest of it in a minute. My grandson Hudson loves to touch the ceiling. Anytime we're close to a ceiling that's low enough, I grab him by his calves and I hit his head many times up on the ceiling. I bounce it up there on the ceiling, and he'll let me. Why? Because he is sure enough that I will protect him and will not hurt him, that he'll put all of his faith in me. Any grandparents understand that? Can I tell you something this morning? Cheryl will not let me do that. She won't let me do that. Will you? No. I could do it, though, if I wanted to, because I'm strong. Faith means being sure of the things we hope for. And the verse goes on to say, and, faith is, knowing that something is real even when we don't see it or if we cannot see it. Okay. So remember back in the Gospel of John, chapter 20, verse 29, excuse me, 25 through 29, the apostle Thomas was not with the rest of the apostles when Jesus made his first appearance. And he says, look, unless I see the nail marks in his hands and put my finger where the nails were, put my hand into his side, I won't believe it. Listen, Thomas had a faith problem. A week later, his disciples were in the house again, and Thomas was with them. Though the doors were locked, Jesus came in and stood among them and says, peace be with you. Then Jesus looked at Thomas and said, put your finger here, see my hands, reach out, put your hand into my side, stop doubting and believe. Thomas said to him, my Lord and my God. Why? Because when he saw Jesus, he recognized him for what he was. Then Jesus told him, because you, Thomas, because you, us, because we collectively, right, have seen him, you have believed. Blessed are those who have not seen him and yet believe. Can I just tell you this? That I have never seen Jesus with my own eyes. I don't know anyone that has seen Jesus with their own eyes. I've heard stories about people that have had near-death experiences and saw Jesus in some way, and I don't doubt those things because I believe that God is just as real today as he was that day he died on the cross, just as real as he was when he created the earth. But I've never seen him. But I'll tell you this, I have seen Jesus at work. When I preach funerals, I try my best to paint this picture of this word picture of how awesome heaven is because I believe in heaven. I believe in streets of gold. I believe in gates of pearl. I believe in mansions all around. No need for the sun because Jesus himself is the light. I believe in all of that. How about you? And I'll tell you what that does for me because I do have that firm belief in that. You know what? If it's wrong, then God's got me all just faked out and fooled. That's okay. That's okay too. Because I'm just going to tell you that if I believe that and I'm wrong, then I go back to dust. If I believe that and I'm right and you're wrong, you miss out on the greatest place ever known to mankind. And I'm going to tell you what, I'm going to put my trust and my faith and my hope and everything I'm in me that God is real because I've seen him at work. Listen, I have a reservation in heaven and it's paid in full. But can I tell you something? I have never been there. And I have never seen it, but I know that it's there. And I believe that it'll be even better than I can imagine. Can I just tell you that Christ did not put us in bondage when he saved us? I was talking with Terry this morning about a guy that he's witnessing to. And he was asking my friend Terry up in the sound booth there, he was asking him, you know, well, I heard that you have to give money to the church. He never heard the word tithe. And Terry said, well, that's my tithe. And he said, well, how much is it? He said, well, it's 10%. 10%? Man, I got two kids. I could never afford that, right? But when you understand in faith that God's not putting you in bondage by giving you that 10%, instead, he's redeeming the other 90% by giving you the 10%. And like Terry witnessed to his friend and says, you know what? My money's always went farther than I thought it would. My money's always been there when I needed it. And the times where I needed more money and didn't know where it was going to come from, it came miraculously. I can't explain that. I just know that it's happened. And I know that it's happened because I know that my God is real. Even though I can't see him, I see the effects of him. I mean, Christ didn't die to put us in bondage. He died to set us free. That's why Scripture says that we're crucified with Christ. God did all the heavy work so we could receive the benefit. And it's all there for us, but it does us no good unless we believe in it. It does us no good to I mean, it's kind of like your car. There was a guy that was trying to get his car to work, and he couldn't. He kept pushing and pushing and pushing, and the guy said, well, have you thought about starting it? That sounds silly, but this doesn't make any sense. We get in the car, we turn the key, and we drive off because we know that it'll most time run. So it is for freedom that Christ has set us free. Are you glad of that? Are you just glad of that? Are you glad that God has set you free? I mean, you think back for a moment of how your life was prior to Christ and how it is now. You say, my life hadn't gotten any better at all, but your ability to sustain and make it has, right? Number two, so faith matters only when you believe it. Faith matters, but only when you trust it. Faith matters, but only when you trust it. Paul said, mark my words, I, Paul, tell you that if you let yourself be circumcised, Christ will be of no value to you at all. Again, I declare every man who lets himself be circumcised that he is obligated, or is obligating himself, to obey the whole law. Okay, so let me stop here and just explain to you why Paul used an illustration that seems kind of random to us. You see, there were some false teachers that were there in Galatia, inside of this Galatian church, that were confusing these new Christians, these Galatian people. These were not Jewish Christians. These were Christians that had came from a more of a pagan society and a godless society. And when Paul came in and won these people to Christ, then they were being discipled by people both who knew the Word of God and who were false teachers who were circumventing the Word of God. And so these false teachers, they call, Scripture calls them Judaizers, were insisting that circumcision was essential for salvation. It'd be like me standing up here and saying to be that you know, to be saved, you had to be, you had to ask Christ in and be baptized. Some people believe that you have to be baptized in order to be saved. Well, it's not true. It's not what Scripture says. I mean, they taught that salvation through Jesus needed the Jewish law system to make it perfect. Is that true? Somebody say no. Somebody else say no. The Galatian believers were about to be circumcised in order to complete their salvation. But Paul explained by this very act, they would be saying that Christ's sacrifice on the cross was not enough to save them, and we know that that's not true. That's why in verse 4, Paul warns them about and warns us about putting our faith in works. So, think about this. When you got saved, whenever it was, vacation Bible school, Sunday school at your home and church, whatever service, crusade, whatever it is, when you came down and you got on your knees and you in some way said, I'm a sinner, I can't save myself, best way I know how, I asked Christ to come into my heart. When you got finished with that prayer, did that prayer partner, did that pastor, did that Sunday school teacher, did your parents say, okay, now you've done step one of getting saved. Now we need to go talk to the preacher and get you baptized. And then we need to give you this list of things to do, this 613 things you need to do. And once you finish all of those, you've turned that assignment in, and then you'll be saved. Does that make sense? That's what the Judaizers were trying to do to the Galatian people by telling them that they had to be circumcised. Now, circumcision for the Jewish people is a big thing, big thing. Before their army would go to battle, there's one place in Scripture that they, after they'd been in bondage for years, that before they went into Scripture, they stopped. The whole army stopped, and all the men were circumcised. Right? I don't mean to be silly, but it was a big thing to them. And so I understand why the Judaizers were teaching this, but they need to understand, and we need to understand, that salvation is not about Jesus plus anything else. It's not about Jesus plus something else. It's not about anything but Jesus alone. Ephesians chapter 2, verses 8 and 9. For if you know this, say it with me. For it is by grace that you've been saved. Through what? It's not of yourself. It's a gift of God. Not by works, so that no one can boast. So look back at verse 4 again. Paul is telling them that there are two very distinct people groups, and I'd tell you that there probably still are here today. The first is in verse 4. It says, you people, you who are trying to be justified means make right, okay? You who are trying to be justified by law, that's the faithless group, have been separated, have been alienated from Christ. And you've fallen away from grace. Listen, you either depend on grace or you don't depend on grace. And that's a choice that you'll make. You either say, God, I throw my life on your hands, or you try to ride the fence in some way. And riding the fence in some way, if you remember, it kind of sickens Jesus. He says, I'll spew you out of my mouth, that kind of thing. So does faith really matter? Yeah, but only when you use it, only when you believe in it. But there's a second group in this verse. But it says, by faith, we, that's the faithful ones, eagerly await through the Spirit the righteousness for which we hope. Now, when we get saved, what is our goal? Our goal is to be the best servant for Christ that we can be. How are we going to do that? Through the Holy Spirit that comes inside of us. That righteousness that we hope for, that we long for, that we seek will come, but it'll only come through the Spirit. Once we get saved, going back to this idea that if I do enough works for God, that I'll be righteous, that's not scriptural. We will be scriptural through a relationship with God that will express itself through some works at times, but it's not about works. The more works that we do, the closer we get to God, is not scriptural. We're going to want to do those things, yes, but as far as making us closer to Christ, it's really more about a relationship than it is about the works. So So does faith really matter? Well, of course it does. It's a matter of life and death. So let me give you some more here. Turn over to John chapter 8 and move down to verses 31 and 32. It'll be on the screen for you. It says, to the Jews who had believed him, who decided to put their faith in Christ and not the law, Jesus said, if you hold to my, what? Teachings, you are really my disciples. I mean, Jesus taught all the way back in John chapter 3 that whoever believes in me won't perish but have eternal life. It's pretty simple. Jesus taught that the ones who surrender their lives to him are the ones that are truly his disciples. And John said that when you get saved, verse 32, then you'll know the truth, and the truth will put you in bondage. Did I get that wrong? Then you'll know the truth, and I love the old black preacher, that truth will set you free, right? The truth will set you free. Faith matters only when you believe in it. Faith matters only when you trust it. And number three, faith matters, but only when you use it. All the way down Galatians chapter 5, verse 13, the Bible says, you, my brothers, were called to be free. Called to be free. Y'all remember me talking about sermons past, about when we get saved, that we drag our past sins around with us? You ever heard anybody that when they were giving their testimony, they spoke 20 minutes about all the bad things they do and only about 2 minutes about what Christ did for them? Is that so counterintuitive to y'all as it is to me? I don't really give squat about what you did, your sins. God hates sin. And for us to focus in on how much sin we did doesn't make a lot of sense. I'd rather talk 2 minutes about how bad I was, and I was too, than I'd rather take the rest of my time talking about how good God is, about the freedom that God gave me from sin, about how bad I was, how lost I was, but now I found, how blind I was, but now I see. I love the fact that God took me, a bad sinner, a cast out, a reject, and made me what I am today. I got a long way to go, but I've came a long way too. And it's not because of how good I am, it's because of how good God is. And it happened because I decided to use my faith. I decided to put it to the test. I decided when things went bad to not trust in myself but to trust in God. I decided to lean on God and not on myself. I decided that I was going to do what God told me to do and not what you folks told me to do, be in the world. I decided that I was going to do what God said to do. And you know what? He blessed it. Why in the world Does someone like me get the privilege of speaking to you folks every Sunday? Because I'm so good? My goodness, no. Y'all know me well enough know that. Because God's so good. Because God gives us a message and God gives us a word. I got to tell you, my little wife, who's about the most bashful, shy person that I know, talented as she is, got the opportunity to speak in front of 3,000 women yesterday. Wasn't that many? It was nearly that many. And she was nervous as a cat in a dog pound, amen? And she studied that lesson, and she studied it, and she didn't get a thing done last week for studying that silly lesson, amen? But she got to speak in front of, what, 200, 100, 50? Some of them were pastor's wives yesterday. At a statewide Inspire conference. I'm so proud of her. But you know what? You got to get past all those. When we got married, I've told this story. She gets mad at me when I tell it, but that's okay. When we got married, she didn't like to go Sunday school because she's afraid she'd get called on to read. Well, how did she go from there to speaking at a statewide conference? Because she had the faith that it wasn't her speaking, but God speaking through her. And when we do things that seem so far out there, listen, don't ever say, I won't do that, because that's where God will put you. But when he puts you there, he will equip you for being there. And so does faith matter? Yes, but only when you use it. My brothers, you were called to be free. You have the ability to let go of the past. The good and the bad, you have the ability to cut the cord of sin from your past and walk on. Why? Because you were redeemed. from your past sin. You were freed. The debt's been paid. You were justified, made whole, made right, made full because of your faith in God. Not because of your works, not because you're so good, not because you're talented, but because God's so good, and he says, I'm going to give you a new life, make you a new creation. Now go out there and serve me. And serve me with the power that I will give you if you will use it. Philippians chapter 3, verse 7 and following. Paul was definitely the smartest man in the Bible. I mean, he'd been through all of the training and the teachings and, was under people, was mentored in this whole Jewish way. This guy was smart. But here's what he said. Paul said, whatever was to my profit, whatever I used to use, I now consider loss for the sake of Christ. What's more, I consider everything a loss compared to the surpassing greatness of knowing Christ Jesus, my Lord, for whose sake I have lost all things. All those things that I used to depend on, all those things I used to lean on, all those ways that I used to go through life, I don't have those anymore because I don't want them anymore because they don't work, and what I have now does work. Somebody say amen. Has anybody ever went through turmoil? Has anybody ever went through controversy? Has anybody ever went through health problems? Has anybody ever lost a job and come back because of their faith in Christ? Has that happened to anybody in this room? Raise your hand. Paul said, I consider them rubbish, trash, something that I don't need anymore and I discard, that I may gain Christ and be found in him, not having a righteousness of my own that comes from the law, but that which is through Christ Jesus, the righteousness that comes from God and is by faith. In my worst time, I have a little anger problem. Have had people from Worcester have anger problems. They just do. But when I feel myself trying to get angry right now, I have to understand that it's not just me who's getting angry. I'm getting angry in the presence of my God. And when I get in the middle of that, I try my best to think, am I going to embarrass God? And I try to look at it like, whatever I say right now is being said from a servant of Christ. And a lot of people don't come to church because they've already been. Does that make sense? Does that make sense? What do you mean, Pastor? They've been to church and they feel the judgment. They see the cliques, all that. Thank God for this church. This church is a very welcoming, very open church. I mean, a lot of times you can't come in this church without people bugging you to death, saying hello to you. But a lot of people see Christians like that. Folks, we need to understand that we represent the God of the universe who has saved us, who has made a place in heaven for us. And the faith that we use will be the outreach to people who don't want it. It says here, verse 10, I want to know Christ and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of sharing in his suffering, becoming like him in his death, and somehow to attain the resurrection from the dead. What does that mean? That means that God has set us free, and I want to live in that freedom. Listen, does that sound like bondage to you, or does it sound like freedom? He went on to say, not that I've already attained all this. And that, guys, that's why if I'm anything, I'm transparent in saying to you that I battle with sin just like y'all do. I fail at that just like you do. And I'm not somebody to be looked up to, but the one who is inside me doing this work is. Not that I've already obtained all this or have already been made perfect, but I'm going to press on to take hold of that which Christ Jesus took hold of me. Last Sunday, March the 3rd, was my and Cheryl's 13th anniversary here at Lakeview Church. 13 years. I'm surprised you kept me 13 days. But that's a big thing for me, and it's an honor for me to be here. I've still got like 8 more years to be here, as long as Brother Pat was before me. But can I just tell you that while I appreciate that, I can't sit down. While I appreciate that, we've not finished the race yet. While I say all of that, it's my goal for me and my goal for you and my goal for this church to press forward, to grab hold of that which has grabbed hold of me. This whole idea of serving God and loving God and seeing other people grow and get saved and work for God, all those things drive me, and they should drive all of us. Because God has, there was a pastor that over in the Pea Ridge, downtown Pea Ridge, they're about to build a building. They called me, they liked ours, and they come by and looked at it. And the guy says, man, y'all have got such a great field over here. People are moving in here by the droves. Boy, y'all just get big automatically. And it hurt my heart. He wasn't trying to be insulting. But it kind of made me think, well, what are we doing? When we got subdivisions filling up all around us, God has given us the opportunity to go out and win so many people for Him. We'll not do it because we're so good. We'll not do it by our programs and all of those different things. We'll do it because we strive for it. We'll do it because we press toward it. So, does faith matter? I wrote this down just like I thought about it in my study time. It only matters if Jesus is who He says He is. Is that honest enough? I mean, isn't there that where faith comes in? That first point in time where somebody speaks something, the Holy Spirit pricks something inside of your heart and goes, well, you know, I've always heard of Jesus, or maybe I've never heard of Jesus, but something that preacher's saying or that Sunday school teacher's saying makes some sense, and I think I do believe. I got some doubts, but I think I do believe in Christ, and I'm going to make my way down that aisle, and I'm going to see what's happening there, and I think I want to have Christ inside my heart, because what those people are talking about, I want inside of my heart as well. I really believe that God is taking hold of us, and the more He takes hold of us, the more we need to be taking hold of Him. And listen, I know what my life looked like before, and you know what your life looked like before, and you look at it now, and if it's not any different at all, you probably need to question whether or not you've asked Christ into your heart to save you or not. It's not my call. It's not my judgment. It's your judgment to look at your life and say, okay, if I've not grown in Christ since I asked Him into my heart, one of two things is probably happening. Either I didn't get saved. Maybe I just came up like you. Maybe you came up like I did when my sister came up when we were kids and got saved. Maybe that happened. Or maybe you did get saved, but you've just stayed there. You stayed there in your safe spot instead of going out and doing what God would have you do. Either way, we need to take inventory of our life to see if God is taking hold of you and you are taking hold of Him. Peter said this in 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 3. Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In His great mercy, He has given us new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Christ from the dead. Go down to verses 8 and 9. It says, though you have not seen Him, you love Him. And even though you don't see Him now, you believe in Him. And you're filled with an inexpressible and glorious joy, for you are receiving the goal of your faith. I think about the time back at a revival in Worcester, First Baptist Church. I said Worcester twice in one sermon. That's my whole allotment for the month. I was sitting in a service, and the preacher was there. We got back from camping that day. It was July 4th weekend. I came to the service because there was going to be girls there. Preacher got up preaching. About half the sermon, I didn't hear it all. Something started pricking my heart, and I started listening to what that preacher said. When it come time for the invitation, I thought, that's what I need. I know I walked an aisle once before, and I said a prayer, and everybody thought I was saved. But when I walked down that aisle this time, I didn't really care what anybody thought. I really didn't care whether people would go, well, I thought he was already saved. What happened? Is he saved this time? I didn't care about all of that. All I knew was that I needed to come to Christ, and I didn't know how. And I walked to the front of that service, and I grabbed hold of Jimmy Terrell's hand, my youth minister, and I said, "Brother Jimmy, I ain't saved. I can just promise you I'm not." And he said, "Well, let's make that right now." We got down. You remember the old altars we used to make? We took a tube of 12 and a couple of legs, and we covered it with carpet. Anybody remember those? And I remember the carpet was ugly, too. It was like some peachy-colored carpet, right? Some ugly carpet. But you know what? It didn't matter, because that ugly carpet had my tears on it. Because I took the faith that God gave me, and I used it. And you know what? When I did, God did exactly what He said He would do. He said, "Whoever calls upon my name will be saved." And you know what happened that little church there? Don't remember what sermon was about, but I remember what happened that night. Because I took the faith and I received the goal of my faith, which was the salvation of my soul. Listen, I can no more show you God than I can show you the wind. But you remember yesterday, in a neighborhood close to ours, I went through there. There was a tree this big that was knocked over. What did that? Bulldozer come through? Truck hit it? No, the wind. How do you know? Well, something was blowing, and then the tree was on the ground. Right? I can't show you God, but I can show you the results of God everywhere. I can show you the result of God in my life. I can show you the result of God in people all over this congregation. I can show you people that went through devastating and catastrophic things, and through the power of God, they made it through to the other side. Why? Because the wind of the Spirit flowed through their soul. So the God question this morning for you is this: will you place your trust and your faith in the only one true God and surrender your life to the one who gave His life for you? Let's stand together. Father God, thank You, Lord, for loving us the way You do. Thank You for being real in our lives, Lord. Thank You, Lord, for being right there with us when nothing else will do and nothing else will work. Lord, I pray this morning for folks in this building right here, Lord, that need to know You as personal Savior. I pray for people in this building right here who need to rededicate their life. I pray for people in here right now that are struggling with their faith. Lord, I think of the man in the Bible that says, "Lord, I believe, but help me with my unbelief." Lord, I pray that You would place us in situations, Lord, where we could use our faith to strengthen our faith muscles, and be with us there, Lord, so that we might understand that You're real, and that we might go to places that we never dreamt of going before. So, Lord, as we come to the quietness of this moment, I pray that Your Holy Spirit will move around this place, Lord, in freedom. Lord, I pray that the Holy Spirit might just come upon our hearts and our minds, Lord, and that we might decide to step out from where we are and make our way to this altar. Lord, we might kneel next to our chair. We might seek somebody out that might want to pray with us or would pray with us. And that, Lord, You do something amazing in our lives and in our church. We pray it, Lord, in the precious name of Jesus. Amen. You come right now. In the quietness of this moment, You make Your way to these altars. Prayer partners are waiting for You right now. You come.
Stay.